Hello everyone, welcome to Analog IAS Current Affairs Analysis for 30th November 2019. There aren't many important articles for the day. I have intentionally skipped the article on climate change in Indian Express because after the COP25 summit, we'll have more and clear information regarding the article. These are the articles for the day and these are the sources. The first article for the day is taken from the Hindu and it is titled "Get an organ donation to tick again." Before we begin this article, let us try to understand what is this about. What do you mean by organ transplantation? That is the first question that we have to understand. The transplantation of an organ from one body to another is known as organ transplant. The person who gives the organ is called the donor, while the one who receives it is called the recipient. Now, organ transplant is done to replace the recipient's damaged organ with the working organ of the donor so that the recipient could function normally. This is transplantation. Now, who can donate organs? Any person who is above the age of 18 years and any person who is related to the recipient can donate the organs after permission from the competent authority. Now, what are the organs that can be donated? Organs that can be donated include kidneys, liver, pancreas, lungs, heart, etc. Also, there can be tissues as well. Tissues constitute eye, skin, bone, bone marrow, nerves, brain, heart valves, eardrums, ear bones, and blood. Now, how can we take these donations? You have two different kinds of donations. One is the cadaveric form and the other is the living organ form. Now, what is this cadaveric form? This is the one in which within hours of the donor's death, the organs are taken out, harvested and transported to the recipient. Another way is living organ donation, in which a volunteer, usually a family member of the patient, donates an organ or a portion of it for transplant. This culture of organ transplantation in India is pretty bad, because if you have to compare globally, Croatia and Spain has the highest organ donation rate at about 37 donors per million, while India has nearly 0.03 donors per million. In India, Tamil Nadu has the highest number of organ donations. Now, are there any laws that regulate organ donation in India? Yes, there is this Transplantation of Human Organs Act 2011. The central issue is organ scarcity is growing rapidly in the last few years. This is because of the increasing lifespan and evolving need of multiple transplantation in the case of heart and kidney patients for longer survival. Now, Article 246 of the Constitution says that public health and hospitals are within the legislative competence of the states. So, every state is making its own transplantation law and there are wide discrepancies within the system. Also, there is this issue of demand and supply gap, because like I've already mentioned, India has a donation rate of just around 0.3 to 0.5 per million, which is one of the lowest in the world. Even the data from the Indian Transplant Registry, a non-government effort supported by the Indian Society of Organ Transplantation, says that only 783 out of 21,000 kidney donors come from cadavers or dead bodies. There is a severe ignorance when it comes to the case of accident victim organs, because they are not used properly. And now we have to get back to our article, which is speaking about this very case. Kerala is known for its altruistic organ donations, but of late there has been a negative perception amongst the people of Kerala as well, because there is a growing suspicion that the well-intentioned organ donations are being misused by private hospitals in order to harvest their organs and profit from them. The growing trust gap between patients and doctors, because the allegations that private hospitals are indulging in profit-seeking behavior, is causing a lot of people to move away from organ donations. Now, how do we build this trust and ensure that this trust gap between doctors and patients is bridged? Now, this is a question that has no straightforward answer. This is a question of ethics. Trust and integrity form the bedrock of any institution's survival in a democracy. Comment. Now, how do we answer this kind of questions? Can we say that public hospitals should take the lead in ensuring organ transplantations? The author says no, that is not the answer, because India spends roughly around 1.2% of GDP on public healthcare, which is very, very low considering the huge population. It is safe to say that our public health delivery system is in a mess ever since our independence, and it has never been living up to its potential. Now, if you want to universalize the coverage of such high priority areas like organ transplantation, this can be considered an unacceptable trade-off, because if you spend minimal amounts on issues like prevention of tuberculosis, the number of people who will be uplifted from disease burden would be much higher. So, the author is taking a utilitarian stance in the case of this article. Now, what do you understand by utilitarianism? Please go back to your ethics basics and try to understand it. What is categorical imperative? What is utilitarianism? Try to understand the difference between the two approaches and try to answer this question. The second article is also taken from the Hindu, and it is titled "Recognize Real Fiscal Deficit, Put Cash in People's Hands." The government came out with its last quarter's GDP growth numbers, and shockingly, it is at a 25 quarter low. If you look at the GDP formula, the components of GDP formula include consumption, investment, government expenditure, and trade balance. Now, except for government spending, every other component is underperforming, and the demand has been exceptionally low ever since 2012, when the government was undergoing a severe crisis thanks to the many scams and policy paralysis exhibited by the erstwhile government. Now, this is a surprising thing, because we have a stable government now, and there is an atmosphere of macroeconomic stability as well. So, given this fact, barring government spending, growth slump has been witnessed across all the industrial and service sectors. There is a contraction in core sectors for second straight month. Electricity has seen a steep fall. And this contraction in 8 key infrastructure sectors of the economy, especially in the month of October, which are the lead indicators for performance in industrial sector, reflect the broader slowdown placing the Indian economy. This article says that whether the government accepts it or not, we are slowly inching towards a recession and not just a slowdown. So it is high time that the government breaches its fiscal consolidation path and put more money into the hands of the people. Because the main problem here is not the supply side, but the demand side. There is low demand because there is no real wage growth rate, or there is no employment growth, or jobs are not growing at the required pace. Now, we have to recollect that the encasing committee has recommended that we stick to our fiscal deficit targets of 3% and debt to GDP ratio of 60%. Now, this is an ideal scenario when there is a proper demand. Since there is no demand, as the data indicates, it is time that we have to breach our fiscal deficit targets, because fiscal deficit targeting will mean nothing if there is no growth in the economy. Now, what is this fiscal deficit, and what is the debt to GDP ratio that we are talking about? What is the proportion of states, that is 40%, the proportion of center, that is 40%, and the proportion of states 20%. What does this encasing committee say about the fiscal consolidation path? Please go back to your basics and read about it. What is the difference between fiscal deficit and revenue deficit? These are the basics of economy that you have to know. Now, in this context, try to answer this question. Examine the steps needed to arrest the dipping economic growth trend. The last article for the day is titled Interception Defining Terrorism, How Gujarat Terror Law Differs from the Maharashtra Law. So this is in regarding the Control of Terrorism and Organized Act of Gujarat, which received the president's assent after 16 years after the assembly has passed the first version of the bill. So this will come into effect on December 1st, and now we are trying to understand how this Gujarat terror law is different from the Maharashtra terror law, which is the inspiration for this law. There are two main points of contention here. One is the issue of interception, and the second is the definition of what we call as a terrorist act. Now, what do you mean by interception? It can be surveillance over your mails, WhatsApp messages, if it can, phone tapping, and all this, which can potentially invade your privacy, can be called interception. Now, do we have any laws governing this interception? Yes, we have the Indian Telegraph Act 1885. And we also have the IT Act 2000. However, these acts do not specify the quantum of punishment. Hence, in this context, the Maharashtra law, which is considered the parent law for the Gujarat terror law, had this procedural component in its law, which states that only a police officer ranked above the rank of superintendent of police is eligible to get this permission for interception or give permission for interception, and that permission cannot be extended beyond 60 days. If you want an extension, you have to file for another application for the extension, and even after the competent authority gives an exception, it is valid only for 60 days. So in a way, there is a proper procedure laid down by law to avoid any arbitrary usage of powers and taking away the privacy of the citizen. Now, we have to remember that in 2017 judgment, Supreme Court declared that right to privacy is a fundamental right in the Puttaswamy case. Now, this kind of laws will impinge on the right to privacy. Now, the second point of contention in the Gujarat terror law, or what we know as the Gujarat Control of Terrorism and Organized Crime Act, is the definition of what constitutes an act of terrorism or the terrorist act. Previously, there was a act called POTA Act or Prevention of Terrorism Act 2002, which vaguely defined a terrorist act as everything that is committed with the intention to disturb public order. So there was a controversy regarding this, because any agitation or any strike expressing a dissent can be termed as disturbing public order, and they can be arbitrarily arrested under Terrorist Act. Even the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, which is India's main anti-terror law, does not allow agitation or any of such form to be called an act of terrorism. Instead, it uses the Indian Penal Code to penalize any wrongdoings during these processions. So there is a controversy stating that the Patidar agitation in Gujarat can be termed as an act of terrorism, and the people like Hardik Patel who launched this Patidar agitation can be arbitrarily detained under this Gujarat terror law. This is against the fundamental rights of citizens. The argument for Gujarat law is that the government can, while framing the rules, introduce checks and balances that are absent in the Gujarat terror law. In case this is not done, there is also the provision where the court can ask the state to legislate. So the state government, while framing the rules, can induce certain checks and balances, like giving the power of filing an FIR to an officer ranked above SP in these cases. Because if you are giving the power to file an FIR to someone of the sub-inspector cadre, there is a possibility that he might misuse this. So overall, what we can say is that ultimately the constitutionality of this law can be challenged in Supreme Court as well, and it is up to the courts to decide whether this law passes the constitutionality test or not. That's it for the day. Thank you.